So in our previous class, we have now we have studied about the various reasons for which the revolt has occurred, and we have studied from the beginning political causes, the social religious causes, and later we have studied even the economic causes that has made the revolt against the Britishers. So the major we have studied this political and later social religious and economic. So among this, the economic reasons we have studied in very in depth and in detail how economically they exploited Indians. And now in this class today we are going to learn about the main military causes for the revolt. See, these all reasons come under the long-term reasons, right? So since many years these reasons have been building up against the Britishers. So what is these military causes? So the word itself suggests that the Indian military, who was working for British, they were finally unhappy or angry with the Britishers. What made the Indian soldiers working for British to get angry and to fight against them or to bring revolt against them? That we will study in this class. Several factors contributed to the change in the attitude of Indian soldiers towards the company. So those several factors are responsible. Let us see what are those factors. Ill treatment of Indian soldiers. Whoever are the Indian soldiers working with British. So you can see in the picture here, the Indian soldiers used to dress up like this, and a British officer used to monitor them like this. So here the ill treatment was given to Indian soldiers. So that means they were not treated properly. So even though they served Britishers in many ways, still they were treated very badly. The East India Company established British Empire in India with the help of Indian soldiers. This, if you understand now, once the Battle of Plassey and all, if you just go back to those concepts, there we have discussed in Awadh, a place where when the Nawab was dethroned of Awadh, based on doctrine of Lapse, 75,000 soldiers, by that time Oud was giving for the East India Company to serve. Such a huge army, isn't it? So these Britishers, they used Indian army and they captured other places, other kingdoms. So now such help was taken from Indian soldiers. But despite the fact that Indian soldiers were efficient as their British counterparts, they were poorly paid. Even though Indian soldiers were used in a full-fledged manner, and the British soldiers and Indian soldiers have equal skills in fighting wars, the Indian soldiers were like equal counterparts to them. Still, the British did not pay good salaries to Indians. They feel them as inferiors. They were not fed properly, food was not given properly, at regular intervals and all, and badly housed. That means the wherever they go and all, the shelter of the soldiers were not taken proper care. But if it is a British soldier, they pay good salaries, they give him nice dignity, they speak with good respect and all. Whereas with Indian soldiers, this kind of things were lacking with Britishers. British military authorities forbade the sepoys from wearing caste or sectarian marks. So this factor also made Indian soldiers, see, India is a diverse land where many religions, many caste and no different traditions were there. The soldiers who joined the British Army, they suppose if he is a Sikh soldier, he is to wear a turban on the head, or if he is another kind of a he belongs to another religion or caste, he has his own caste, his own religious that was like they make some if you look at this picture here, see, he is wearing a turban on his head. There's like some kind of religious, what do you call, practices that soldiers used to follow in India, beard growing. But the Britishers said, no, you have to give up all those religious practices if you belong to army. So they completely interfered with the religious practices of even the soldiers also. This showed the disregard for the sentiments of the sepoys. The sepoys felt so much hurting when the Britishers asked them to remove the turban, shave your beard and all, they felt it is against the religious sentiment, which they didn't like. So here the problem started between the soldiers and the British or the East India Company. The other reason was General Service Enlistment Act. What does this act meant? According to traditional belief, it was a taboo for a Brahmin to cross the sea. The British Parliament passed General Service Enlistment Act in 1856. As per this act, Indian soldiers could be sent overseas on duty. See, during those days, even Britishers were, I mean, sorry, even Brahmins used to serve in army, and they have a religious taboo. Taboo means that they should not do such things. What was the taboo among British, I mean, Indian Brahmin soldiers? If they cross the sea and go, they lose their caste, which is Brahmanism. That was their traditional belief. If they cross the sea and leave the place, then they become, out of the religion. So the Britishers know, but so they never used to go for outside wars. Whenever Britishers take them outside for wars and all, they're not allowed, they never used to travel on the ships and all. But according to this act in 1856, so everybody has to travel. So this act created problem between the Brahmin soldiers and the East India Company. This act did not take into account of the sentiment of Indian soldiers. They didn't give respect at least. So this, the Brahmin soldiers saw this as a danger to their caste. This led to a feeling of resentment. So they felt that, yes, they are wantedly, the Britishers are trying to make us give up our practices, which is not good for us. So they felt like that hurting, and they were now very angry on the British. According to this act, the soldiers have to travel on the sea, and they have to fight even outside the countries also on behalf of British. But if they go like that, the Brahmins, they had a belief that they'll lose their caste if they travel on sea. That was their belief. We can't say why it all, why it came and all. So that was the thing, reason, one of the major reasons for the gap between East India Company and Indian soldiers. So in the military causes, we have studied certain acts and what was the treatment given to Indians or Indian soldiers. So the larger proportion of Indians in the British Army was also a major reason why, Indians could easily revolt against Britishers. The number of British troops in India was never very large. So with a very minute amount of army, they were controlling the majority, parts. How was it possible? It was possible only because majority of the soldiers were Indians, and these soldiers were loyal to Britishers. That was the only reason why they could easily, capture all other places. But still, they were treating the people of Indian soldiers in a very bad way. So like it was as low as 1 in 4,000. If you take 4,000 people, it was very negligible amount of British soldiers used to present. Mostly they use all Indian soldiers for their purposes, for their military purposes. And Dalhousie, who was the Governor General, he also recommended that the more British soldiers should be recruited in the army. He sensed in a way that, always there should be more British soldiers. So he even gave a recommendation that, so now from at least from the hereafter on, I mean, at least after here onwards, they should recruit more Britishers into the army, and so try to reduce the strength of Indian soldiers. However, this could not come through. Okay, this was not possible. You cannot recruit such huge, you cannot bring such huge army into, India and maintain that army, in a big way. If it is Indians, they could save a lot of money, even though they ill-treat them, they pay less salaries. Still, the soldiers used to work loyally. That thing will be, cannot be seen if Britishers were brought into that scene. So Dalhousie tried his best to recruit more Britishers into army, but practically it not come possible. That it is made easier for the large number of Indian soldiers to take up arms against British. So this also was a factor, all the Indian soldiers were more in number and the Britishers were less in number. So it also added as a factor so that they can easily revolt against the Britishers. And the bleak prospects of promotions. So bleak means very sad, very negligible promotions used to given to Indian soldiers. all higher positions in employment were reserved for Britishers. So all the highest post in military was only given to Britishers, irrespective of their performance. Even if a soldier performs well, or if a little higher rank Indian soldier works better, he'll not be getting any promotions. Only Britishers used to get promoted irrespective of their performances, because only on the feeling that they are Britishers, they used to take away them for higher posts. Indian soldiers formerly occupying higher positions in the armies of native princes could not rise above the rank of a subhedar. So earlier, whenever they capture a kingdom, if the commander of the kingdom is there, of that particular army, he also joins Britishers. But even though he joins as a, commander and all, he has to serve as a soldier, that's all. So very rarely few people got promotion, and many of the soldiers who were even higher ranked during the princes and kings, they were also limited to the post of a subedar. So like a soldier, they were not allowed to any other higher rank positions. The future of Indian soldiers was bleak, without chances of promotions. So soldiers also felt very unhappy because they're hardworking, they're even though they're getting less salaries and all, they were still not promoted. This kind of, feelings became more and more with the Indian soldiers. And deprivation of allowances. See, the extension of British dominion in India adversely affected the service conditions of sipahis. So how did the service of sipahis got affected with British ruling in India? They were required to serve in areas away from their homes, without extra payment. Suppose if this is a place, and suppose the Britishers, they travel some 100 kilometers and all, or some, there they have to fight and occupy a kingdom. Now what happens? The soldiers from this kingdom, they'll take them here and they'll leave. When they work for Britishers away from their home, it is their right to get some extra allowance apart from salary. They have to pay some extra allowance, right? So allowance is needed some. So these allowances were called as bhattas. Okay. And sometimes even the soldiers were taken to foreign nations outside the India to fight on behalf of British. Even then, they were not given any kind of extra money. That's their extra job, right? They are serving outside their country, away from their homes, leaving all families, and still they could not get any kind of extra allowances. Instead of giving extra allowances, they also brought an act called Post Office Act 1854. According to this act, it withdrew the privilege of free postage enjoyed by sipahis. Suppose if a soldier who is working for East India Company, he'll go for somewhere, or some other country, to fight against, the British enemies. There, if they want to communicate to their families, they have to write letters, right? And this postage of letters was free earlier for any Indian soldier. But Post Office Act 1854 removed that service also. Even though they are outside the homes, away from the families, they don't get service of communication free of cost. Also, they were deprived from having any extra allowances. See, this is all building up in the soldiers, very rapidly, so that they get angry, finally it resulted in revolt. So another mistake that was done by British was faulty distribution of troops. This also added as a factor for the immediate rise of revolt. So places of strategic importance. So in India, the Britishers have established certain important places, and they have kept armies, so that they can take control over at an emergency situation and all. So this practice we see even today in our country. We have certain zones here and there throughout India, our army is kept, right? So that was a practice we learned from Britishers. So at an important places like Delhi, Allahabad, the British had no armies and were wholly held by Indian soldiers. So this factor is not any problem to Indians, but we were discussing about the military reasons, right? So in that distribution of troops, they did a mistake. The Britishers did a mistake. What they did, at very important places like Delhi, Allahabad, they kept completely Indian soldiers. No British armies were there. the Indian soldiers dominated the strategically important places. And besides, England was engaged in several wars outside India. So on one hand, the Britishers, you know, they were fighting with outside countries. And on the other hand, they kept within India, which is their colony. They kept Indian soldiers only to took I mean like you know to monitor those important areas. So the mistake they did is they kept soldiers at important places completely, you know, with Indian soldiers. There were no major British soldiers and all. Completely Indian soldiers used to dominate these important places. At the same time, they have to fight wars with other countries also, like Persian War, you know, Crimean War, which happened between Russians and Britishers, and the Chinese War. Like this, no, the Britishers were always engaged in wars outside India also. Indian soldiers had the feeling that British were in difficulty and the safety of Indian Empire depended on them. So why do you think Indian soldiers got so courage to revolt against British? Because strategically at important places, Indian soldiers were dominating and they felt that anyhow Britishers are busy with the outside wars and within India they are completely dependent on our strength. So they felt it is a very useful factor or a very confident factor so that they can easily attack Britishers. Why they have revolted against Britishers? Because they felt yes, the British is completely dependent on our strength. Also at the same time they are busy with the outside wars. So all these factors also gave certain kind of confidence for the Indian troops. Therefore they determined to strike at them at suitable time. So from here the Indian soldiers have prepared their mind to attack the Britishers. So poor performance of British troops. So the British army suffered major reverses in the Afghan War, Punjab Wars and the Crimean Wars. So if the Indian soldiers were observing what these Britishers were doing, when they went out and fought with Afghans, they were losing the wars. With Punjab, they lost the war. With Crimean Wars, where they have to fight in Crimean Peninsula, Russia and British and French and Ottoman Empire, there were certain wars which were called Crimean Wars. In that Crimean Wars also, the British lost. And this gave confidence to British troops. They felt, no, they are losing their grip throughout the world slowly. That means they are becoming weak. So even if we revolt, they cannot stop us. This was the confidence that Indian soldiers developed before the attack. And in 1855 and 56, the Santal tribesmen of Bihar and Bengal, armed with axes and bows, rose up against British, temporarily sweeping away the British rule from that area. See, the Santals, who are like local tribals in Bihar and Bengal areas, they could drive or they could make the Britishers leave their areas with just axes and bows. The tribal war, the basic primitive tribal war which they did with the mighty Britishers who have used guns and gunpowder. They could drive the Britishers away from that place temporarily. This gave a lot of confidence to the soldiers. The tribals with no modern weapons, if they could drive away the British from their area, why can't we? So this was the one confidence that Indian troops developed. Though the British suppressed the Santal uprising, the disasters they suffered broke the myth that the Britishers were invincible. So till then, till the Santal tribe temporarily defeated Britishers, nobody imagined that we can defeat Britishers. But the tribals have proved that with the basic weapons they have. So of course Santals were later taken under control by British, but they could rise against British. Till then nobody used to think that they can rise, but they have broken that myth that they can even defeat Britishers. So that revealed to Indian soldiers that the British army could also be defeated by the determined Indian army. So if the Indian army determines very strongly, it is not that difficult to defeat the British soldiers also. This started developing among the Indian soldiers. The lower salaries, the wages of Indian soldiers were inadequate to support their families. So work was more, the wages they get was very less. The British soldiers, on the other hand, they received 8 times more than the salary that an Indian soldier received. Such a wide gap with equal work between Indian and British soldier, it has risen a kind of resentment with the Indian troops. The salaries were 8 times less than the British soldiers. The British soldiers, in spite of less work, they get 8 times more salary than an Indian soldier who works more than the British soldiers. So this created a resentment finally. So till then, we have studied the long-term reasons for the rise of revolt. Now we are going to study about the immediate cause, the triggering cause. All these years, now there has since the Battle of Plassey till 1856, there are many factors slowly getting piled up for the against the British in various sections of Indians. And in 1856, an immediate triggering factor happened, which made the revolt to rise immediately. The British authorities decided to replace the old-fashioned musket by new Enfield rifle. See, they wanted to replace the weapons with soldiers. There were some old weapons which they were using. Now they want to replace those weapons with modern Enfield. So you can see this Enfield here. This is a kind of the gun that they wanted to give to all the soldiers. And the loading process of the Enfield rifle involved bringing the cartridge to the mouth and biting off the top greased paper with the teeth. So in this cartridge, generally, the bullets and all will be loaded. So here, this is the cartridge. And to load this cartridge into the rifle, here, what happens? They have to bite this top portion, okay, and remove the paper. If you see the difference, this is the removed one. This is the top, and this is the top portion removed. They have to remove this and they have to insert into the rifle. Now, what happened? In January 1857, there was a rumor in Bengal regiments. What do you mean by Bengal regiment here? These are the important places. Okay. In those days, army was divided into regiments: Bengal regiment, Madras regiment, Delhi regiment. They call this as a place where troops will be present. And they'll be ready to work for the British at any time. So, in the Bengal regiment, there was a rumor spread that the greased cartridge had the fat or cow or pig, fat of cow or pig. So, this greased cartridge, which is present here, this has to be removed by with mouth. So, when they have to remove this with mouth, the cap is made up of cow or pig fat. So this was a rumor that spread among Indian troops, especially among the Bengal regiment. Now, how do you think the soldiers can open it with their mouth? The Sipahis were now convinced that the introduction of greased cartridges was a deliberate move to defile Hindu and Muslim religions. So here the Britishers, this was a rumor, this is not truth actually, but they felt that this was not made up of any cow or pig fat, but they felt that this was wantedly introduced by British to disrupt the practices of Hindus and Muslims. The cow is very holy for Hindus, and now the Muslims, they don't like pig. Now, if you think this cartridge is made up of pig's fat or cow's fat, do you think the Hindu and Muslim soldiers, who are the majority soldiers, will use this cartridge? No. Muslims hate pig, so they don't use the cartridge. Hindus feel the cow is a sacred animal. They won't use the cartridge. So both Hindus and Muslims refused to use these cartridges and staged an uprising when they're forced to use them. So finally, the Bengal regiment soldier said, "We are not going to use these cartridges." But the Britishers forced them to use. So obviously, the immediate result of that was the revolt. The soldiers, they revolted against the British policy of using them cartridges. When the rumor was spreading like this, and the regiments, especially the Bengal regiment, rejected the use of these cartridges on February 26, 1857. Remember this date, February 26, 1857. The 19th Native Infantry at Berhampur. So infantry means soldiers who fights on land, okay, at Berhampur in Bengal. Remember this Berhampur and Bengal. They refused to accept the cartridges given to them. So, you know, in Bengal, this was the 19th regiment, and now it was Berhampur, and they rejected outrightly that they are not going to use these cartridges. And this regiment was disbanded as a warning to other regiments. So all the soldiers were suspended in this regiment. They were not taken into services, and they were removed from their services as a warning to other regiments. The British has felt that other soldiers also might follow this, and they have disbanded. It means they have removed them. But the Sepoys feared loss of their caste and religion if they accept the greased cartridges. So the Sepoys also felt. On the other hand, they cannot accept the cartridges because they can't remove the cartridges, which is made up of cow or pig fat, which is also a rumor. And in the process, Mangal Pandey, a Sepoy who belonged to this regiment, Bengal regiment, led an attack on the adjutant of the 34th Native Infantry at Barakpur on March 29, 1857. See, February, they said they refused, that regiment refused. So it was removed. Then by March 29th, what happened? Mangal Pandey attacked an assistant. Like, you know, if there is a higher senior British official, there will be next level officer to him. Senior most British officer will be there, military officer. Under him, no, there will be another officer. What Mangal Pandey did, he attacked on this assistant to this British officer, or next level officer to that British military head. And because I know he almost killed everyone there, because they were not allowing them to disband in the practice of removing the cartridge. So he attacked and he killed them. Mangal Pandey was later executed after a court martial. Court martial means the military officials, they sat together. They have decided, they have given the judgment that Mangal Pandey has done a crime against the government, and they are they executed him. That means they given death sentence to him. So for his fellow Sepoys, he became a martyr. That means all other soldiers felt that Mangal Pandey is so brave, and he died for the purpose of the soldiers. So he is to be ever remembered. So Mangal Pandey became the first soldier to die fighting against the British. So the meaning of First War of Independence started with the execution of Mangal Pandey. His attack on British officer and later his execution, as has been described by historians as, the first attack on Britishers. So that was the immediate, thing that happened after the revolt. So Mangal Pandey started the revolt, and many other soldiers, they also started involving, they started rejecting the practice of removing the cartridge. And let us see what are the events that happened after the March incident. See, in March, Mangal Pandey did that revolt. And the news of the events in Bengal spread like a wildfire to all other places. So Feb, they rejected. By March, the revolt began. And by May, it spread to all other parts of the India. On May 9th, 85 Sepoys refused to touch the cartridges on parade ground. So in a place called Meerut. So you can see Meerut here, which is near Delhi. Okay, in this place, the regiment Sepoys said they're not going, 85 soldiers said that they're not going to use the cartridges. As a result, they were sentenced to 10 years of rigorous imprisonment. So the British officers, what they did, they have imprisoned those 85 soldiers. On May, all the Sepoys at Meerut rushed to the jail and set free their comrades and other convicts. So when their own soldiers were kept in prison, the other soldiers in Meerut, they could not digest this. So they revolted against the Britishers, and they went to the prison or the jail and set free their comrades or friends, or their friends who were imprisoned, that 85 soldiers. And slowly from Meerut, the revolt spread to Delhi, so which is very close. See here, after Meerut, the it is spreading like a wildfire. Now the revolt spread to Delhi. The soldiers from Meerut came to Delhi the next morning. So the soldiers are in full energy. They just came to Delhi now, and they were joined by the local infantry. Even the Delhi soldiers now who belong there, they also came as a support to the Meerut soldiers. They seized the city and proclaimed the aged Mughal Emperor Bahadur Shah as the Emperor of India. The soldiers from Meerut, they came to Delhi, they joined hands with the Delhi soldiers, and altogether they have seized the city. They have driven away all the British troops from Delhi, and they proclaimed the Mughal Emperor Bahadur Shah as their Emperor of India. So finally, the soldiers have driven out the Britishers from Delhi, which is strategically important place for them. And he was also coerced to write, soldiers in Meerut have given so confidence to Bahadur Shah that he wrote letters to all the chiefs and rulers of India, urging them to organize a confederacy of Indian states. So the soldiers asked Bahadur Shah to write letters to all the rulers of all the kingdoms in India, saying that it is time to get united against British. So Bahadur Shah wrote letters like that to all the other chiefs and rulers of India who are also loyal to British, but he wrote letters that this is the right time, all the soldiers are with me, so if you all join hands with me, we can drive out the British away from this country. So this was the theme of the letter that Bahadur Shah sent to all the rulers of India. And in the process, the British lost Delhi. So as soldiers from Meerut were huge in number, and Delhi soldiers also joined hands with them, finally the British lost Delhi, which is strategically very, very important place for Britishers. And later on, Sir John Nicholson, who was a British military general, he surrounded Delhi, and after 4 months of attack, he captured Delhi back again. So knowing this, that Delhi, which is an important place, went into the hands of Indians, and they proclaimed Bahadur Shah as an emperor and all such things, Sir John Nicholson was appointed by East India Company to take control on Delhi. So after 4 months of fighting, Delhi was taken back under British control. So what was the result of that? Bahadur Shah, who was proclaimed as emperor, was found guilty of aiding the movement. So British said that Bahadur Shah should not have done such kind of thing. He should not, even though the soldiers have proclaimed him as emperor, he should have stepped out. But he remained as emperor, and he wrote letters also. So he made him to feel guilty as for the mistake he did. And the British have shot dead two sons of Bahadur Shah, and he was sentenced to life imprisonment in Yangon jail of Myanmar. So Bahadur Shah was sent to Myanmar as a lifetime imprisoner, and Delhi was taken back under their control. Even the sons of Bahadur Shah were killed by Britishers, and he was the officer, Sir John Nicholson. So later, no, Bahadur Shah died in this Myanmar in 1862. So after February, next in March, Mangal Pandey incident, and by May, Meerut and Delhi incident have occurred. So I hope you have got a clear understanding how this revolt was spreading. So the revolt was spreading like wildfire. It started at Barakpur in Bengal, and then it slowly spread to Meerut. From there, it is spreading to Delhi, right? Now, the revolt even spread to Lucknow. So Begum Hazrat Mahal, the wife of Nawab of Awadh, he led the uprising at Lucknow on May 30th, 1857. So Begum Hazrat Mahal, the wife of Nawab of Awadh, led the Lucknow revolt. In Lucknow also, Begum Hazrat Mahal take the 1857 or the revolt against the British troops. The city was by May. Okay, so still in May, we are in May. So it started in Feb, continued till in March, Mangal Pandey, and by May, Delhi Meerut. And within the May, we have even seen the revolt at Lucknow by Begum Hazrat Mahal. And there, Awadh was recaptured by British in March 1858. So 1857 finished. Now the year proceeded to 1858. Okay, so by 1858, 1857 May, Begum Hazrat Mahal, she raised a revolt. By 1858 March, okay, again it was recaptured, and Begum Hazrat Mahal, she fled away to Nepal. So she went away to Nepal to protect herself, and later from here the event spread to even Kanpur. In Kanpur, Nana Saheb led the struggle for independence of Kanpur, and the British surrendered in June 1857. A large number of Englishmen, women and children were captured by an infuriated mob. So here what happened? However, in Kanpur, Nana Saheb could drive away British. British got surrendered to Nana Saheb in 1857 itself, and British men, women and children were captured by a group of soldiers in Kanpur. The British defeated Nana Saheb, and later, no, after they came to know that Nana Saheb has captured many British soldiers, women and children, the British went in a huge manner and they captured even Kanpur back. And Nana Saheb also, he fled away to Nepal. Begum Hazrat Mahal as well as Nana Saheb, they both left to Nepal. His general Tantiya Tope escaped to Kalpi and another important place. So Nana Saheb and Begum Hazrat Mahal, you can see in the pictures here, she was out the queen and he was for Kanpur. So they both left, and Tantiya Tope, who was the general of the Nana Saheb, he also left to Kalpi, a place. And these are all at northern part of India. What was the central portion of India, with central portion of India? Like you take Jhansi and Gwalior. The battle also began at Jhansi in 1857 June. Okay. Sir Hugh Rose laid siege to the fortress of Jhansi in March 1858. So even at Jhansi, there was a revolt by Rani Lakshmi Bai, and because of traitors, that means some cheaters within her army, the fort lock was opened and the British troop can enter easily into the fort, and the Jhansi Rani also escaped from fortress to join Tantiya Tope at Kalpi. Okay, so Rani Lakshmi Bai, she also escaped from she fought bravely, but she could not manage with the troops, and she immediately left to Tantiya Tope to take his help. The Rani died fighting British in June 17, 1858 at Gwalior. Tantiya Tope was betrayed by Gwalior Chief Man Singh and was hanged. So he was Sir Hugh Rose, and he was an important person in capturing Jhansi. And Lakshmi Bai and Tantiya Tope both got killed. Lakshmi Bai was killed in Gwalior by Britishers, and Tantiya Tope, who was taking shelter with Man Singh, the ruler of the place where he resided, when he informed this news to the Britishers, they came and hanged him to death because he worked against Britishers. So now with this, Man Singh was also hanged. Sorry, Tantiya Tope was also hanged. Thus, the revolts were also suppressed by the Britishers. So there are many other important places where the Britishers, the Indian troops have also revolted, like Bareilly, Khan Bahadur, okay. And if you take in Bihar, the struggle was led by Kunwar Singh. I'm just saying, the center, Bareilly, okay. You can see that in map. And Bihar you take, so here Bareilly is there. When you take Bihar, it was led by Kunwar Singh. And at Faizabad, it was by Maulavi Ahmadullah. In Bengal, Rohilkhand and Bundelkhand, Central India and other parts, Bihar of East and East Punjab, many parts, there were revolts against British. Some of the states in India, the rulers remained loyal to British government, but their soldiers rose against the British. This is a very important thing. Even though the rulers were loyal to British, the soldiers in different states, many of the states they revolted, but some states the rulers remained loyal, but the soldiers, they rose against the British rule. And in most of the places, common people also rose up in arms and fought with the axes and spears, bows and arrows. Such was the, you know, resentment, that was the anger that Indians have, you know, for many years they were having that pain, that they were taking in various forms of British. So here, if you look at the struggle, I'll conclude this. If you look at the struggle, each area had a different reason. Suppose you take Bihar. Here Kunwar Singh revolted because his zamindarship was taken away. And here Ahmadullah, you take, he just wanted to represent the Muslim community because Muslims were looked very badly. So the revolt of 1857 was a failure. If you look at the consequences of the revolt was failure. It was partly successful and mostly failure. Because why it was successful? Because it gave a confidence to Indians that they can also rise against British. Why it was failure? Because each place in British revolted on for a certain cause. Okay. Everywhere you take Jhansi. Why do you think Rani Lakshmi of Jhansi revolted? As per doctrine of Lapse, her son is not allowed. Adopted son is not allowed. So she fought against British. I know you take any place, there was individual reasons for everyone. Why this revolt failed? Because this revolt, I know strategically places were very far away from each other. And mostly the people, no, the soldiers were not having unity at different areas. So there are many reasons why the revolt failed. But there is a major reason that this is also successful in showing to Indians how, that yes, they can also fight against Britishers. So with this, you know, we'll finish up the syllabus part, which is, you know, the reasons and the centers where the revolt raised up.